As a BPO student, I have no conflict of interest. And my topic here will be the role of microbiota and nutrition and metabolism, nutrition metabolism, and bioavailability. As an introduction, because we have seen already all these data, but just to remember, we have an increasing concentration of microbes when we go down to the gastrointestinal tract and near the distal gastrointestinal tract, we have almost 10 to the 12 cells per gram, which is a lot. So we define the gut microbiota, all the the microbiota start after the stomach. But let's see it from the adsorption point of view. We know that, and we have seen some examples in the previous presentation, we know that we have some compounds that can be absorbed at the level of the stomach, but others are not. And because they are too big, or maybe they are apolar. So these compounds will get into the intestine, where they will be used as substrate by microbiota, and the resulting metabolites will be at their turn absorbed, and as they will be able to cross the intestinal barrier. So adsorption is not only in the stomach, but we have also a lot at the level of the intestine. And this is very important because we now have to define what is bioavailability. The definition of bioavailability in nutrition science is a tricky concept. It's not as easy as in pharmacology, where there is a kind of consensus on the definition of bioavailability. But in nutrition science, we have a lot of, there are many different definitions. So I pick up a definition that was not exactly what I think of bioavailability, so I add two other concepts, metabolism and excretion. But what we can say is availability is absorption. Absorption is a key word in bioavailability, I think, and some use interchangeably absorption and bioavailability. But I think the concept of bioavailability should encompass the availability of the absorption, bioaccessibility, the absorption itself, metabolism, as we have seen. That the microbiota is very important. Distribution, bioactivity, and also I add excretion, which is now very near from the IDMA concept, of course, the absorption, distribution, metabolism, and excretion patterns. What we can say is, from this point of view, from this definition of bioavailability, we can say that the microbiota enhances bioavailability of some compounds that are not, as we have seen, able to cross the stomach barrier, for example, and they go to the intestine, and they are metabolized, and then the metabolites can be bioavailable. So microbiota is very important for this. The contribution of gut microbiota to human nutrition through the production of these more bioavailable compounds is then essential. And I would like to come back to, I think, an, a, a prime example of this. We have seen previously this example of the synthesis of short fatty acids from dietary fibers. And just to remember, we have non-digestible, what was known previously as non-digestible polysaccharides, and they can be metabolized by microbiota into short fatty acids that we know are quite easily absorbed at the level of the intestine. So I have a question. Can we see, or can we still say that dietary fibers are not bioavailable? I think a response to this question is at least partially. And this is a paradigm shift in nutrition science. We know that these compounds that were previously, we thought previously that were not absolutely used by the body and were excreted in feces, we now know that a percentage of it can be used by the body. And the thing is, we are not all equal in front of this, and there is a huge variability. Some people will be able to obtain more short chain fatty acids from these compounds, and other not. So let's see another outstanding example that was also previously presented by Dr. Ayan. It's the in vivo metabolism of isoflavones. It was presented previously that the dadzine, for example, is a compound very important of soy-derived products, and it can be metabolized to two compounds equal and all the methyl ambolensin. Okay, but we now know that as microbiota is necessary to do this metabolism, there is a huge variability between individuals. And but when we see it more in details, there is not too much intra-individual variability. What I mean with that is the fact that when we produce equal, it's quite stable. It's quite a stable status. We are not. For example, if you eat soy today, and we see that you are a good or a high equal excretors, because we measure it in the urine. Probably in few years, if we do the same test, you will remain in this category. And there is some scientific papers who also try to see if it's possible to change this status, and it was very difficult. The use of probiotic, the common probiotic, for example, were not able to change this status of equal or no equal excretors. So we come up to a new concept, which is metabotype. Is to say, if you belong to this category of equal producer, metabotype, your microbiota metabotype is almost, we can label it like equal producer or not equal producer. And as we have seen, it's very difficult it's very different according to the geographical region. For example, in Western countries, an average, as was said before, only 30% of people are equal producers. And in Asian countries, it's much higher, probably due to diet, but also we don't know really if it's diet or genetic, because some people who, of course, in Asian countries they eat a lot soy-derived products, so we can think that maybe it's because of this constant exposition to soy-iso flavors, their microbiota was somehow used to metabolize this compound. But there is also people in Asia that are not able to produce equal, and people in Western countries that were not used to eat soy-derived products, but they had the ability to metabolize equal. And the same is the same case is about to lesser extent, but it's more or less the same to the other compounds, some ODMA, O-dimethylambolensin, is somehow there is about 20% of the people who are not able to produce this compound. So we can assume, hypothesize, that there is about 4 metabotypes among the population for Danzian, for example, metabolism. And we can have, for example, people who are able to produce both compounds, another one or the other. And some people who are not able at all to excrete equal or ADME. So this is very important from the functional point of view. You know that, for example, in the 90s, the gynecologists were quite interested in giving to them to the post-menopausal woman with symptoms of menopausia. They thought that it was possible to treat the symptoms with soy-derived products, because the same symptoms, for example, were not so abundant in the Asian population. And the clinical studies on isoflavin extract, for example, were almost always inconclusive, because exactly of this, because a lot of people were not able to produce equal. I forgot to say that equal has an estrogenic activity. Studies that show when we stratified the people according to their ability to produce equal or not, we can find health effect. It's something quite interesting, because for us, when we want to develop a functional food, maybe, and prove that it is a functional food, we see that it is very difficult. Because how the legislator can take into account the fact that this food is functional for someone, but it is not for another one. It's very difficult from this point of view. But maybe people in the future will know their metabolite status, and so they will know if a functional food is good for them or not. And so, in this case, as I said, there were good correlation. If you stratify the people according to their metabotype, you can find quite a good correlation with some health biomarkers like cardiovascular obesity and bone density. Another outstanding example is the metabolism of elagitannins. And that's a work we have done at the University of Costa Rica, and you know, elagitannins is a molecule, quite big molecule, that of course is not bioavailable as such in the stomach, can cross the barrier, But when we do a clinical study with healthy volunteers, constantly we show that the most discriminant compound is these ones, urolithins. This family, the compounds that belongs to this family, urolithin A and urolithin B, and we come up to a metabolic chain, if you want, of diverse compounds. And you see, this is the big ellagitalins that it transform by some microbial enzymes, or even sometimes the pH of the stomach, in smaller molecule that is used as substrate. And it is a constant thing in the intestine. It means the compounds becomes more and more apolar, and then it's more easily absorbed through the intestine barrier. And so it's the first one after, it's the first discriminant compound or biomarker of exposition after drinking, for example, a glass of tropical highland blackberry juice, which is very rich in ellagitalin, much more than pomegranate, that is also well known for this, and walnut and other food source. And if we show also that if we look in details, we were able to discriminate between people, for example, that were able to produce urolithin A, but no urolithin B. As well, for example, maybe they didn't have the microbial enzyme arsenal to go further in the metabolism. So they were just excreting urolithin A with another group that were able to excrete more urolithin B and somehow some urolithin A. Another group that was unable or very low excretor of urolithin A and almost nothing of urolithin B. So we look at this stratification of people to see if it was something stable, and of course we always see a huge inter-individual variability in the production of urolithin. You see that some people also during the time, some people were able to produce, for example, urolithin just 12 hours after, for example, drinking the juice, and others were able to produce urolithin up to even detectable urolithin 8 days after one single shot of blackberry juice. And this was proved to be quite stable. We did this, giving a glass of juice and just assess or measure the urolithin in urine 4 days after, for example, drinking the juice. And we saw that it was quite stable. So we can say that there is, in this kind of metabolism, we have a large inter-individual variability, but a quite low intra-individual variability. People don't change so easily their way to metabolize, for example, this kind of compound. And we also try to assess the prevalence of those metabotypes. So we were able to classify people into metabotype A, which were the people who produce urolithin A, metabotype B, the people who produce urolithin B, and the people who were not able to produce neither urolithin A or urolithin B. And in Costa Rica, for example, on more than 90 people from the university, student and staff university, we found out that the For example, there were a lot of non-producers of Eurality. And the same a team in Valencia, which is very well known from Professor Barberin, did the same thing but using pomegranate, and they found that in Spain the urethane producer was were much more higher in number than in Costa Rica. I was surprised by this data because I said it's strange because in Costa Rica, for example, the main juice the Costa Rican people used to drink juice when they eat, and the main juice in Costa Rica is blackberry juice, and I didn't understand why so many people are not able to produce urolithin, while in Spain, for example, they are not drinking pomegranate juice every day, but it's like that. And it is very important for also, the same as equal, it was very important to understand why some people can have health benefit from L-glutamate and other people not. And some recent studies showed exactly that the clustering according to the urolithin metabolite, for example, explained the, for example, the improvement of cardiovascular risk. For example, if you take this clinical study and you just make an average of the cardiovascular, for example, biomarker, you may not come with the conclusion that it's good for health. But if you stratify the people according to their metabolite, you will be able to see a statistical improvement of this biomarker. So it's very important, to my point of view, to know to which metabolite you belong if we want to see, for example, a beneficial effect of consuming, for example, L-glutamate. And also, what is strange is, for example, here you have three metabolites, and the three metabolites may expect different effects, health effects, when they drink, for example, blackberry juice. Some people from metabolite A can expect, for example, an improvement of biomarker of overweight and cardiovascular disease. Those who are producing urolithin B can expect, for example, a better regulation of skeletal muscle mass. And those who are not producing urolithin, they may not expect a health effect, at least from urolithin, when they eat the isoflavones. And also in the team in Spain, they were able, for example, to see, to make also an additional differentiation between obese people, for example, that have different metabolite preference. The third example is the lignin from gut microbiota, and it's more or less the same, but we don't know exactly how many metabolites, for example, there is, but we know that, for example, the it's very difficult to pronounce secoisolarisinol, which is a compound of flaxseed, can be metabolized into enterolidol and into enterolecton, and it's the, more or less the same thing. These are bioactive compounds, and they maybe exist metabolite, but we don't know exactly. And I think the list is very huge. We are just starting to understand and to know this is a list. I'm sure that this list, this is the main bioactive compounds I found in the literature that are mediated by microbiota. And I'm sure that we can be able to find other metabolites. And so the characterization of gut microbiota, I think a lot of people speak about the characterization from the taxonomic viewpoint through metagenomic, etc., and to know what's the name of the microbes from the microbiota. But I think another way that is very important is to classify or to characterize the gut microbiota from the functional point, viewpoint, what it's doing. And metabolomic is the tool for knowing that. And to come up with stratification into different metabotypes, which can maybe explain the health effect we can obtain. And I will finish with this presentation before conclusion. How we can do this? And we are trying at the University of Costa Rica, for example, to develop a beverage containing your blackberry, soy flavor, flaxseed, and so on, and to come up with a test, for example, doing this and 4 days later, doing this during 3 days and 4 days the next day, the fourth day, give my a spot of urine, and I will say to which metabolite you belong and what you can expect maybe of the health effect. And we will do this, for example, with El Cimiso America in a blue zone in Costa Rica, where people live more than 100 years old. So we will see if maybe we can find a correlation between their metabolites for these compounds and the health status. So as a conclusion, the stratification of volunteers according to their microbiota metabolite, I think is very important to reduce the large variability of biomarkers